Good morning, everybody. I hope you can hear me. Lovely to be with you once again. As they say, when the cat's away, the mice can play. Before we begin, I'm going to read the banns of marriage. I publish the banns of marriage between Robert James Shufflebottom and Charlotte Natalie Whedon, both of this parish. Also between Ben Kimpton and Catherine Horswell, both of this parish. Each of these are for the first time of asking, and if anyone here knows any just cause or impediment why these couples may not be joined together in holy matrimony, you must declare it now. Good. Our opening hymn this morning, All My Hope on God Is Founded, 3, 6, 8. Gathered here this morning as God's people, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. We have gathered together, in the name of Christ, to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek forgiveness of our sins. that by the power of the Holy Spirit, and strengthened by sharing God's gifts, we may give ourselves to the service of God and all people. Amen. Jesus said, "Before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled. As brothers and sisters in God's family, we confess together, asking our Father's forgiveness. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen." Almighty God, who in Jesus Christ has given us a kingdom that cannot be destroyed, forgive you your sins, open your eyes to God's truth, strengthen you to do God's will, and give you the joy of his kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. collect for the fourth Sunday before Lent is followed by the collect for the Queen's Platinum Jubilee. O God, you know us to be set in the midst of so many and great dangers that, by reason of the frailty of our nature, we cannot always stand upright. Grant to us such strength and protection as may support us in all dangers and carry us through all temptations, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive, reigning with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, the fountain of all goodness, bless our sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth, and all who are in authority under her, that they may order all things in wisdom and equity, righteousness and peace, to the honour and glory of your name, and for the good of your church and people, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive, reigning with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We sit for the reading.
First lesson is taken from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 1 to 11. Paul declares the essence of the gospel, Christ's death and resurrection. In all that he does, Paul sees his work for the gospel as not by his own efforts, but by the grace of God working in him. Now, I should remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins and in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to someone untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The gradual hymn 372. hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to thee, O Lord. Now it happened that Jesus was standing one day by the lake of Gennesaret, with a crowd pressing round him, listening to the word of God, when he caught sight of two boats at the water's edge. The fishermen had got out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, it was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and pay out your nets for a catch." Simon replied, "Master, we worked hard all night long and caught nothing. But if you say so, I will pay out the nets." And when they had done this, they netted such a huge number of fish that their nets began to tear. So they signaled to their companions in the other boat to come and help them. When these came, they filled both boats to sinking point. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at the knees of Jesus, saying, "Leave me, Lord, I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were completely awestruck at the catch of fish they had made. So also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were Simon's partners. But Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, it is people you will be catching." Then, bringing their boats back to land, they left everything and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Lord, fill my mouth with useful stuff and shut it when I've said enough. Amen. Please sit. I'm not pointing the finger at anyone in particular. This is a generic sort of statement. I think we are strange creatures. We are more lovely than we think. We're also more sinful than we imagine. Hard, too hard, and too easy on ourselves, and we do this all at the same time. In the Old Testament reading this morning, Isaiah received a vision to which he reacted with shame. "My eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts, but woe is me, for I am doomed. I am a man of unclean lips, living among a people of unclean lips." And in response, an angel swoops down with a burning coal to cleanse his lips. He is doomed, all right, but he is doomed to be made clean through suffering, to be made able through it to speak of God. As I've said to you before, Jesus saves us from our sins, at least in my understanding, can be rephrased, love redeems suffering. And in the second reading, ably read, thank you, St. Paul says that Christ appeared to him last of all, as to one born abnormally. "For I am the least of the apostles, not fit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God." Unworthy? Yes. But did the grace of God discard him? No. It appointed him a key apostle, even though he'd never even met Jesus. Then there's the famous gospel story just heard. Jesus tells Peter, James, and John to fish in the deep water where they'd already been with no result. And without warning, their nets are overflowing with fish. And Peter cries out, "Depart from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." So God's being so bounteous, so generous, so overwhelmingly gracious. And our response is, "Oh, I can't cope with this, go away." We're a funny bunch of folk, aren't we? Both goodness and sin, for which the ordinary word is selfishness, together constitute our real identity. Most of the time, I'm very happy to believe, in fact, we are quite generous. Often we're generous to a fault. Most of the time, despite appearances, I'm sure we are warm and hospitable. The same is true in terms of the desire and scope of our embrace. You hear of disasters in Afghanistan, and if you like me, you well up with tears in your eyes. It is so appallingly tragic. Same is true of the desire and scope of our embrace, both in our minds and in our hearts, inside of everyone, easily triggered by the slightest touch of love or affirmation, lies a big heart, a grand soul, itching to show itself. Mostly the problem isn't with our goodness, but with our frustration in trying to live out that goodness in the world. Too often, we end up looking to others cold and self-centered, when the truth is, actually, we're only hurt and wounded. So, we don't always look good, but we are. Mostly, we're frustrated precisely because we cannot, for reasons of circumstance or wound and sensitivity, we cannot pour out our goodness as we would like, nor embrace the world and those around us with the warmth that is genuinely within us. We go through life looking for a warm place to show who we are, and mostly, we don't find it. We're not so much bad as frustrated. We are more lovely than we dare imagine. That's the half of it. Inside us too, congenitally, there is selfishness, jealousy, pettiness of heart and mind that is never far from the surface. I was hearing of such things before the service. Moreover, generally, I include myself, we are blind to our real faults. Conversely, it's those areas where we think that we are virtuous and righteous that most often our real sin lies, where others struggle with us. I'm glad Barbara's not here to affirm that loudly. For example, the dear old C of E always puts a lot of emphasis on the sixth commandment. Sexual ethics. And we've not been anywhere remotely near as self-scrutinizing in regard to the fifth commandment that deals with bitterness, judgments, anger, hatred, or with the ninth commandment, or with the tenth commandment that have to deal with jealousy. It's not that sexual ethics are unimportant, but our failures therein are easier to see and harder to rationalize. The same is not true for bitterness, anger, righteous anger, or jealousy. It is, sadly and no doubt wrongly, much easier to rationalize these and not notice that jealousy is the only sin that God felt it necessary to prohibit in two commandments. So, we are both good and bad. We are both generous and selfish, big-hearted and petty, gracious and bitter, forgiving and resentful, hospitable and cold, full of grace and full of sin, all at the same time. And what's more, we're dangerously blind to both, too unaware of our loveliness, too unaware of our nastiness. To recognize this is both humbling and freeing. The bottom line, in essence, you and I are loved sinners. Goodness and selfishness constitute our real identity. Not to recognize the truth of either leaves us either unhealthily depressed or, quite possibly, dangerously inflated. Too hard on ourselves or too easy on ourselves. The truth will set us free, and the truth about ourselves is that we are both better and worse than we picture ourselves to be. In Holy Communion, we echo that famous Roman centurion who says, "Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed." I suppose, like all the characters in the three readings this morning, we could react with shame. But notice, far more importantly, God does not say in return, "I reject you." He says, "I love you dearly. Come, be with me. You are a fine human being." So, fine human beings, let us stand and face east from where Christ will return as we declare our common faith. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In the power of that Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
To the bidding, Lord, hear us. Responses, Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord Jesus, you taught your people from the shallows of the lake. Inspire teachers of your word today to present your good news in ways that people understand and respond in faith. As your church, we've faced the challenge of COVID and responded with innovation and the use of the internet and have stayed in touch with those who are in need of pastoral support. As we move forward, help us to continue to see new ways of caring for your people and spreading the good news to those who do not know your love. May the gospel of truth once again capture the imagination of our nation. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord Jesus, you encourage tired fishermen to put out again into deep waters, delighting them with a catch beyond measure. and we become weary in our serving of you and your people. Help us to hear your voice and to cast our nets where you guide. Help us not to resist your call to new ways of serving you. We ask you to raise up leaders of integrity who will inspire this nation and other nations to strive for justice and peace. And we lift before you the Ukraine, Afghanistan, Sudan, Ethiopia, Yemen, Lebanon, Somalia, Venezuela, and many other areas of the world. May our nation and other nations seek for peace rather than using smaller, less powerful nations as pawns in their battle for power and resources. Give persistence and courage where opposition to your peace seems overwhelming. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
A prayer for the Queen. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ exchanged the glory of a heavenly throne for the form of a servant, we thank you that you have given Elizabeth, our Queen, a heart to serve her people, and have kept her devoted in this service beyond all who are before her. Encourage us by her example to serve one another and to seek the common good, until you call us all to reign with Christ in your eternal kingdom. Amen. Amen. Lord Jesus, friends and partners struggle together to haul in the catch. Give us grace to work for all that strengthens the bond of communal life. Help us to work with other churches, those of other faiths, and those of none, for the good of all. Thank you for the organisations such as the Maple Tree Community Cafe, the WI, the Royal British Legion, the Lunch Club, and those who work with young people such as Brownies, Cubs, Scouts, and the Football Club. Sustain all that foster the common good. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord Jesus, you brought encouragement to the weary and fresh hope to the despondent. Lift the hearts of all weighed down by sickness and anxiety. We pray for Martin, our vicar. May he soon return to full health and to his ministry with us. And we pray for those who need our long-term support, for Andrew, Lynn, Ian, Samantha, Ted, Alf, Kay, Claire, Audrey, Joan, Robin, Carl, Shirley, James, Michael, Lorna and Richard, Sally, Don and Hazel, Steve, Rachel and their children. May they know your presence and your power to heal. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord Jesus, you appeared to your disciples risen from the dead. Fill us with this hope in grief and at the hour of our death. We pray in particular for Jean Appleby and Peter Williams. May their families, friends, and all who mourn them know your presence and your strength at this time. And bring us all to rejoice in your salvation and to trust that we will join with them in your heavenly kingdom. We say together, Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, that when we meet in his name, and pray according to his mind, you will be among us and hear our prayer. In your love and mercy, fulfill your desires and give us your greatest gift, which is to know you, the only true God, and your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
the peace. The disciples were gathered together in the upper room when Jesus appeared amongst them to say, "Peace be with you." And they were glad when they saw the risen Lord. Whose peace be always with you. Thank you. Peace. Our offertory hymn is number 287, Broken for Me. With this bread that we bring, we shall remember Jesus. With this wine that we bring, we shall remember Jesus. Bread for his body, wine for his blood, gifts from God to his table we bring. We shall remember Jesus. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts, we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God of hosts, for all the earth is full of your glory. From your heavenly throne, you touched the lips of your prophet Isaiah to remove his guilt, and you sent him to awaken your people. In the fullness of time, you sent your Son, proclaiming through his lips your promise of life, and through his death and resurrection, your forgiveness of sins. At his ascension, he sent forth his disciples in your name, trusting your good news to the lips of the redeemed. And so we give you thanks and praise in the great company of sinners become saints, joining together in their unending hymn. Plenteous God, as you transformed fishermen into followers and filled empty nets with more than their boat could hold, show us your abundance in the joy of this feast. Sanctify us by your Holy Spirit, that we might be faithful followers sent into the world in strength. By your same Spirit, make this bread and cup here before us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who, at supper with disciples, took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. God of holy presence, in your temple what is ordinary is made holy. Before your throne of grace, make your children into prophets of peace and heralds of mercy. Bless every man and woman, every boy and girl with courage to follow where you call, trusting the depth of your promise. Meet with your grace every soul rendered an outcast by the judgment of others, and restore the fallen as your faithful followers. Renew your church to seek you in your dwelling places among the poor and the forgotten, the sick and the imprisoned, the hungry and the homeless. Gather all your children into your holy presence as you draw angels around your throne, until we enter your eternal temple in fullness of joy and dwell with you forever, one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. As this bread is broken, so may we be broken. As Christ was broken and resurrected, so may we be made whole. Let us now receive with faith all that God offers us through the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us share together in remembrance that Christ died and lives for us today and be fed by his spiritual gifts freely offered us. The gifts of God for the people of God. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. The blood of Christ shed for us all. Go before us, Lord, in all we do with your most gracious favour, and guide us with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, receive everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We give thanks for God's goodness as together we pray. You have opened to us the scriptures, O Christ, and you have made yourself known in the breaking of the bread. Abide with us, we pray, that blessed by your royal presence, we may walk with you all the days of our life, and at its end behold you in the glory of the eternal Trinity, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Are there any notices that aren't on the sheet? No. Fine. Please feel free to take them home and peruse them at your leisure. The blessing. May the light of Christ pierce the darkness of the world. May the love of Christ lift your spirits and gladden each day. May the peace of Christ fill your hearts and minds. May Christ our Saviour walk by your side today and all your days. And the blessing of our eternal God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you now and evermore. Amen. We come now to our final hymn. And at the end of our final hymn, there'll be a brief pause, and we'll together sing the first verse of the national anthem. 398, 398. quite the Twickenham rugby pitch, but never mind. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.